Good morning, folks, and welcome to Zion Lutheran Church here in Chelsea, Michigan. We're excited that you joined in. It is a beautiful morning here, a little bit on the cold side, but it's winter. It's been snowing all weekend, and I love snow. I hope you do as well. Anyway, have you ever felt like this? I have plenty of times. That's called stress. And Jesus says something pretty interesting in the Bible. First of all, stress, we know, doesn't discriminate. But he says that we can have, or that he can give us, that peace that surpasses all human understanding. And we're going to learn more about how Jesus was able to have that sense of peace. Because like us, he had those moments where he was really stressed, but yet he was able to neutralize and manage it. So why don't you join me for worship? I'm going to get ready, head into the sanctuary for worship. I'm just excited that you are here, and I hope that you are blessed by our worship. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Loving and compassionate and peaceful God, we thank you for this beautiful morning that you've called us together here. And we know that at times, life can be really stressful. And the last thing we experience is that peace which surpasses all human understanding that only you can give. So in the midst of our stress, God, let us look to Jesus, who is the way, the truth, and the life, the one who gives us that peace in the midst of that chaos and stress that can be life. Pour out your Spirit upon us. In the great name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
The reading today is from Paul's letter to the Philippians, beginning in the 4th chapter. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we thank you for a blusty, wintry morning. But we thank you for the warmth of your spirit and the warmth of your love as we gather here. Open our hearts, Lord, as we deal with this whole issue of stress. We know all of us desire more peace in our life. Bless our time together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This morning, we continue with our series called Snapshots of a Savior by taking a look at one of those areas that offers the better life that I'm sure most of us wouldn't mind having a little bit more of, and that is peace. Yes, peace. Peace in the midst of stress. Now, when thinking about peace, I want us to think of the word shalom, because it's a word that Jesus would have used that has a much deeper meaning than the English word peace. Shalom means harmony, completeness, prosperity, welfare, tranquility. Shalom means wholeness, a total well-being of, you know, your mind, body, and spirit. Shalom. Now, on a scale of 1 to 10, where are you when it comes to this whole shalom thing? Are you a 10? I doubt it. Maybe a 9? I'll bet it's fair to say that most of us are like maybe a 6 or below. That would be my guess. Okay, now how about the opposite of peace? Stress. On a scale of 1 to 10, where are you there? Probably fair to say 5 and above, maybe. If you have teenagers, you're probably hovering around a 9, maybe a 10, on the verge of a nervous breakdown and wondering if it's even possible to ever live the better life of peace. Now, if we want to live the better life, a better life of peace, and we want to avoid the pitfalls and reduce the stress and tension in our lives, then we need to look at Jesus. Because remember, Jesus is the guy who was sleeping in a boat who seems pretty peaceful in the middle of the storm while his friends were freaking out. Do you remember that story? And if anybody had stress and tension in their lives, hands down, it was Jesus. He did. I mean, there wasn't anybody who experienced more stress than Jesus Christ. Think about it. His life was under constant demands We have it. Story after story after story in the Bible tells us that. People were always, you know, after him, always wanting his attention. Lots of demands. Yet what amazes me is that Jesus never got depressed or gave up or let that stress, you know, control him or get the best of him. Did you ever notice that? Jesus always seemed to be able to manage or at least neutralize whatever stress came his way. I mean, Jesus was living the shalom thing. His countenance was one of peace. He was living the better life. He was living the kingdom life, the life of the kingdom, which is supposed to be peace, as the Bible says. So as I said, I think it's fair to say that all of us this morning can benefit from learning how to manage and reduce the levels of stress in our lives, because stress is a part of everyday life. It's like breathing. And like Jesus, there's not a person sitting here this morning who hasn't experienced stress in some way at one time or another. In fact, if you don't have any stress in your life, well, you're probably dead. Maybe due to stress. Now, the danger of stress in our lives is that if it's not managed, if it's not like neutralized or reduced, it can have a debilitating effect on our lives. Stress messes with us. We know that. It messes with our joy. It can mess with our sanity. It can mess up our attitude and our outlook on life. Stress can rob us of that peace, that centeredness. It can hinder you from being the very person that God created you to be. Stress, a lot of it around. Listen to what I found. I did some research. Listen to what I found about stress. 4 out of 5 adults and children suffer from some form of tension and anxiety for a prolonged period of time. It's a lot. 71% of all those who visit the doctors or have a doctor's appointment are stress-related disorders. Stress causes fatigue. It causes weight gain, chronic headaches, irritability, memory loss, low self-worth, low self-esteem, depression, high blood pressure, shallow breathing, tightness in the chest. I've experienced that. Nervous symptoms, a change of sleep patterns. Yep. And a lower sex drive. Yikes. 80% of all illnesses are caused by stress. Crazy, isn't it? And it's a major contributing factor, either directly or indirectly, to coronary heart disease and cancer and strokes, respiratory disorders, accidental injuries, and suicide. There's no question that you and I live in a stress-filled world. The question is, how do we minimize and manage our stress so we can have a little bit more of that shalom thing going on in our lives? How did Jesus do it? How was he able to manage all that stress? As I said, Jesus always seemed to have this calm demeanor about himself, no matter what the circumstances. Nothing seemed to, you know, rattle Jesus' cage or rock his boat. And he had loads of pressure. Yet, when we look at his life, you see that he had a real sense of balance. I mean, what was Jesus' secret in living the better life of peace? Well, that's what I want to talk a little bit about this morning. Principles that Jesus lived out that I think will help us in our quest to manage and reduce the amounts of stress in our lives so that, like Jesus, we can live that better life of peace. And the first way to live the better life of peace is know who you are. Know who you are, the principle of identification. And it's a very important principle if we are to live that better life of peace. Again, take a look at the gospel that I read, John 8:12, when Jesus says this. When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." And when Jesus says, "I am the light of the world," what was Jesus doing? What was he saying. He was defining himself, wasn't he? He was saying, hey, I know who I am. I am the light of the world. In fact, over 18 times in the Bible, Jesus says, I am. It's called the I am statements. And then he says, I am, and then he gives this description. He says, I am the door. I am the bread of life. I am the vine. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the good shepherd. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I am the resurrection and the life. Over and over and over, Jesus defines himself. Jesus knew exactly who he was, and as a result, he was able to live the better life of peace. How about you? Do you really know who you are? Do you know who God created you to be? Do you know what God's purpose is for you? What he wants you to do? Who he wants you to be? Because if you want more peace in your life, then hear me on this. Don't let others define you. Don't try to be somebody that you're not. It doesn't work. Ask anyone who's been down that road before. I've been down that road. It does not work. And folks, this is the first principle in living the better life of peace, because if we don't know who we are, unsure of our own identity, unaware of who we are, who God created us to be, we are then going to be pressured into other people's mold. I mean, people will try to make you into what they think you ought to be rather than what God made you to be. And one of the major causes of a lack of peace in life comes from trying to be somebody that you're not, never being satisfied with who you are. And you know what's worse is we play those tapes all the time in our heads, don't we? Thinking we need to be somebody that we're not. I mean, it's nuts, but for whatever the reason, we do it all the time. Oh, if I just was a little bit more like that person, oh, then my life would be better. Oh, I wish I had that person's talents or that person's qualities. Then my life would be better. Oh, I wish I could be like that leader. Then my business, then my church would be more successful. Oh, I wish I looked like that person, or I had that body. Man, they got it going. You know, that six-pack. Trying to be somebody that we're not. And all it does is lead us to dissatisfaction, frustration, and maybe even depression. Trying to be somebody that you're not for the sake of a boyfriend or for the sake of a parent or a spouse or maybe a boss or a friend. Folks, when it comes to living the better life of peace, the only way you can compensate or counterbalance outside external pressures that create all that anxiety and stress is to have an internal sense of satisfaction about who you are and who God made you to be. And folks, you discover who you are by knowing whose you are. You want more peace? Then stop trying to be somebody else. Because when you keep trying, you're missing out on the very life that God has given you. You know, I believe that self-rejection is one of the greatest enemies of the spiritual life. And why do I say that? Because it contradicts the sacred voice of God that tells you and me that we are wonderfully, beautifully created in the image of God. You belong to God. Tell the person next to you, you are God's chosen. Hey, you are God's chosen. You're chosen. Folks, you've been chosen by God, adopted. You're highly favored. And God deeply loves you and cares about you and accepts you just as you are. And that's good enough. Know who you are. Because if you don't know who you are, you will always have a restless spirit. That battle going on in your mind and spirit, that feeling of discontentment in the depths of your soul. Number two, if you want to reduce stress, and live the better life of peace, and know who you're trying to please. Jesus says in the 5th chapter of John, "By myself I can do nothing. I judge only as I hear, and my judgment is just. I seek not to please myself, but him who sent me." Did you catch that? I seek not to please myself, but him who sent me. See, Jesus settled this issue in his life. I mean, Jesus dedicated his whole life to pleasing God. He wasn't trying to please himself. He wasn't trying to, you know, please other people. He was only trying to please God. And he knew that if he did that, it would always be the right thing. Because the issue is, let's be honest, we can't please everybody. Amen? So Jesus said, "I'm going to center on pleasing God." And folks, we create enormous, I mean, think about it. We create enormous amounts of chaos and anxiety in our lives when we try to please everybody. But we can't. Yet that doesn't, for whatever the reason, it doesn't seem to stop us, does it? It's called people pleasing. Man, I can be like that, trying to please everybody. But we can't please everyone. That's true in business. That's true with our own families and with our kids. It's true in the church, if you can believe that. We can't please everybody. In dealing with people, there are going to be conflicts of expectation that creates stress. But you have to settle. Who am I going to please? Otherwise, you're going to be torn apart by 15 million different people. The key to living the better life of peace is faithfulness. Faithfulness and doing what is pleasing in the sight of the Lord. That's what matters. See, Jesus never let fear or rejection manipulate him. Never. And he wasn't controlled by the opinions and the approval of others either. You want less stress in your life, more peace, then know who you're trying to please. Number three, you want less stress and more peace, then make a habit of personal prayer. Pray. Luke 5:15 says this about Jesus. The news about him spread all the more, so the crowds of people came to hear him and be healed. But Jesus often withdrew to lonely places and prayed. Prayer is one of the core values of Jesus' life. No matter how busy Jesus got, he took time to pray. I mean, Jesus, he was a praying machine. It was his lifeline to God, as it was for Paul when he says in Philippians 4:6, "Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus." You know, no matter how busy and stressed out Jesus could have been with the expectations of others, he always made time for prayer. Quiet time with the Father. So let me ask you, when was the last time you got off the treadmill we call life and just sat still? When was it? I mean real quiet time. Quiet time with God. No radio, no iPad, no TV or computer, no Facebook or tweeting or texting, no TikTok, no cell phone. I mean, when was it? When was the last time just you and God chilling out with each other for 10 minutes or 20 minutes, 30 minutes? When was the last time? You know, Psalm 46 says this, "Be still and know that I am God." Folks, true intimacy with God is found in your quiet time. If you never carve out quiet time with God, sacred space, you will never know God intimately. Sunday morning just isn't enough. You want to live the better life of peace, then commune with God in those quiet places. Practice prayer. Talk to God. Tell him, man, what's on your mind and what's in your heart, because he cares. Read the scriptures. Listen and discern what God is saying. Because God loves you and God wants you to have that peace. Number four, if you want less stress and more peace, then take time off to enjoy life. I call it the principle of relaxation. For some, it's called retirement. Mark 6:30 says this, "Then the apostles gathered around Jesus and reported to him all they had done and taught, and they were exhausted. Then because so many people were coming and going, they didn't even have a chance to eat. And Jesus said to them, 'Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest.'" Obviously, they didn't have McDonald's back then, right? But see, Jesus knew the importance of decompressing. He did, of resting and relaxing, taking some time off. Jesus looked at those gathered around and said, "You are burned out. You're fried out. You need a break." When we look at Jesus' life, again, we see that Jesus frequently had chill time with the Father. He went to the mountain, didn't he? Or he would go to the desert or some rest. Or better yet, he often would get into a boat. Jesus had boat time. I love boat time. It's why boating is biblical. Amen? The Bible says in Genesis that God finished the work that he had done, and he rested on the seventh day. He blessed it. God made it holy. In fact, God made it. It was so important, he made it one of the big 10. Why? Because rest and relaxation is important to God. And Jesus reminds us of that too when he says that man was not made for the Sabbath. The Sabbath was made for man. God knew we needed it. See, Jesus was able to live the better life because he was able to be at peace under constant pressure, because he enjoyed life. He knew that life was too short to get all stressed out and not to live. He took time out to smell the roses and to focus on the things that, you know, that were important in life. And there's nothing that reduces stress more than getting away from the hustle and bustle that life can be. Am I right? Maybe going to the cottage or being with family or being out in nature, hunting, fishing, or taking a hike, hanging on the boat with family and friends, reading a good book, enjoying a hobby. Hey, we need to work. There's no question about that. But we also need to play and enjoy this one and only life with family and friends, to enjoy all that God has given to us, to smell the roses. Jesus was at peace. He knew how to live the better life because he knew how to relax. So my challenge for you this morning is this. Do you want to live a more peaceful life, a more blessed life, a more enjoyable life? Then know who you are. Know who you are trying to please. Make a habit of personal prayer. Take time to enjoy this one and only life and turn to Jesus, who says in Matthew 11:20, it's one of my favorite verses, "Come to me, all you who are weary, who are stressed out, depressed, at the end of your rope, who are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me." Did you hear that? "Learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your weary souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." And when you do, you will be on your way to the better life of peace. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we know that life can be a rat race, and there's so many variables out there that can stress us out and that can really put a burden on this beautiful life that you've given us. We know that stress is inevitable. Jesus had it himself, but yet he was able to manage it and neutralize it because he sought after your heart. Lord, you meet us in those places of stress. you teach us how to navigate through those times of great difficulty. Bless us, Lord, so that we can experience the better life of peace like Jesus did. It's in his mighty name that we pray. Amen. We continue with our hymn. Peace of the Lord be with you. Before we begin communion, I just want to thank you once again for giving of your time, your talents, our possessions. When we share these things with one another, God can turn a little into a lot, and we can bless people not only here locally, but all over the world, and we are because of your generosity. So thank you so much for all of your support. We've been talking about the snapshots of Jesus, and we see how Jesus handled stress. And as we heard, stress can get the best of us at times. One of the things I love about our faith is that God comes to us in so many different ways. He comes to us through the Word, which we just heard, but he also comes to us every time we gather around this table. We are reminded that he is present, and in the midst of our stress, he is the one that can give us that peace. So if you're stressed in any way or burdened in any way or worried in any way, Jesus is here with us. That's his promise in this meal that we celebrate, full of grace and full of love and full of peace. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O holy God. You are the light and light of all. By your powerful word, you created all things, and through the prophets, you called your people to be light to the nations. Blessed are you for Jesus, your Son, our Savior. He is your light, shining in our darkness and revealing to us your mercy and love. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Thank you, Jesus. A Again, after supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks, and he gave it for all of them to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people. It's for the forgiveness of their sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Thank you, Jesus. Remembering, therefore, Jesus, his preaching and healing, his dying and rising, and his promise to come again, we await that day when all the universe will rejoice in your holy and life-giving light. By your Holy Spirit, God, bless us and this meal, that refreshed with this heavenly food, we may be light for the world, revealing the brilliance of your Son, Jesus. Through him, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit, both now and forever. Amen. And let's pray that prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, being mindful of what we are praying. And together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. We're going to continue with communion. And remember, this is a meal of community. We are all gathered here, even though we are gathering virtually. Jesus binds us together. And we are brothers and sisters of the one faith, renewed in spirit and in love. We continue with communion.
Gathering together after communion, let us pray. Gracious God, in this meal, you have drawn us to your heart. and have nourished us at your table with food and drink, the body and blood of Christ. Now send us forth to be your people in the world and to proclaim your truth this day and evermore. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. We'll now offer prayers of intercession. I will end each petition with, "Hear us, O God," and I invite you to respond, "Your mercy is great." Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. For the church, for ministries of healing and wholeness, for hospital, hospice, and military chaplains, for those serving in prison ministry, for all who proclaim freedom and release in the name of Christ. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. For creation, for snow and sun, for plants and animals, for lakes, woods, fields, and forests, for the humility to take our place among all the creatures of the earth. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. For the nations and peoples, for all who serve in cities, towns, states, and countries, for state, local, national, and international health organizations, that in times of trial, fear, or hopelessness, they find freedom in service to those most in need. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. For all wearied by life's burdens, for those who are poor, for those lacking supportive relationships, for those crushed by debt, for those struggling with chronic pain or other sickness, for those exhausted from overwork or stress, for all who cry out to you, especially those who have COVID-19 or who have recovered from it, for those on our prayer list, and for those on our hearts that we say out loud or silently now. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. For this congregation, for outreach and social ministries centered here, especially the Warming Center and our B3 environmental care, for parish nurses and visitors, for ministries of companionship and support, for the young people in this place who open us to new understandings. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Merciful God, hear the prayers of all your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Hey, thanks for tuning in and worshiping with us this morning. If you are looking for a faith community to grow in your faith and to maybe explore the tenets of Christianity, Zion is a great place for that. We have a lot of growing opportunities as well as serving opportunities, and we would love to have you be a part of our faith family. If you have any questions, give us a call at the office, check out our website, our Facebook page, or you can call me at 810-599-3490. Would love to get to know you, have some spiritual conversation, whatever kind of a conversation you want to have. Coming up for this coming week, just want to remind you that immediately following our in-person worship, by the way, we're in person again. It's limited capacity, so you have to sign up for that. But we are back in the sanctuary, social distancing, wearing our masks, and being cautious. And again, if you want to sign up for that, that would be great. Just you can check it out on the emails that go out every Friday at the Friday update. But we have our annual meeting today, Sunday, immediately following our service. You can join us via Zoom, or you can attend here. But again, you have to sign up. So there's two options. We'll be social distancing, and it's limited to in person. That is for our annual meeting. Hey, we have a lot to celebrate here at Zion. This past year, it's been tough, but we've been able to accomplish a lot in the name of Jesus. And we want to celebrate what we've accomplished this past year, but we also want to celebrate our future. The Bible says, God says that He gives us a future with great hope. And Zion's best days are yet to be, so you want to hear a little bit about that as well. Other things coming up, we have a youth event today as well. Sledding, if you want to be a part of that, call Kirk Heading, and he'll get you all the information. I'm heading with him, so it should be a lot of fun. Also, on Wednesday, we have a Bible study. You can join us via Zoom or here on site, and we're ripping the part, the book of Luke at 10 o'clock. Also that evening, on Wednesday evenings, we have gathered around the word and prayer, and it's a little half-hour service just to connect, just to check in to see how everybody's doing, and grow a little bit in the word, share a little bit, pray a little bit, and then wish each other a good night's rest. That's on Wednesday nights. I'm going to be starting up a men's Bible study. Hey, guys, once a month, we need to grow in the word, be spiritually strong in our faith. So if you're interested, give me a call. Call the office. Love for you to be a part of it. It'll be once a month, a men's breakfast. Also, we have opportunities, ample opportunities to serve here. If you are interested in bringing a new blanket or gently used clothing, or coats, drop them off here at the church, and we will then make sure they get to the warming center in Ann Arbor to help our brothers and sisters who just struggle to have shelter, adequate housing. So it's one of our ways to say we love you, we value you, and we care about you. All right, that's all I have. Hey, I hope you have a great week. Remember that God loves you. Don't get all stressed out and all worried. God's got your back. All right, he'll help you navigate through it. And brothers and sisters in Christ, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue with our sending song.